Like any historical philosopher, every parent is going to run into a situation where they get asked that question. You know the question, the one that you need an amazing answer to? One that is going to impact your child, so you need to get it right? And like any smart dad, the first thing I did when my son came and asked me was say, go ask your mom. Of course, she's way brighter than me, so he said, I already did, and she told me to ask you. So of course, I said, listen, this is pretty important, because what he actually asked me was this. Why are so many people in the streets? And what are the signs that they're carrying? And why do they look angry? And where are they going? And what are they doing? So I said, well, listen, this is important, and it's gonna take me a second to answer this. So go grab your brother, and I'm gonna make you guys lunch, and we're gonna talk about it. So they come back in, and this is the look that I get. Now, with that look, you know I had to bribe him to stay for lunch. So I made his favorite lunch, and then I began to talk about what was going on. So here is all of these people in the streets, and they want to know, million men, what are they doing? So of course, I have to say to them, the reason they're in the streets is a very important thing. And that thing is, everybody, the people at home and the people in the streets, need a voice. They're looking for what us adults call justice, right? But for you to understand, justice is simply a voice, a way for you to get across what you want and be heard fairly. Think about it this way. What if dad said to you, I know you broke the window, so I'm gonna punish you, and I put you on a week's punishment. No TV, no iPad, no anything. But you were trying to tell me how it wasn't your fault, but I didn't listen. And what if your brother came in, the same scenario, and I said to him, don't worry about it, we're gonna let it go. Would that be fair to you? And of course he goes, no, Dad, first of all, I didn't break a window. I said, listen, Jordan, I understand you didn't break a window. No problem, that's not the point. It's just an example. But would that be fair? He said, of course it wouldn't be fair. So I said to him, listen, here's what we're looking for. Here's what you wanna know. People wanna be heard. And the reason why they're so angry looking is because they're afraid. People are fearful. He says, afraid of what, Dad? I said, they're afraid that they have a voice and they may lose it. And they're afraid that they don't have a voice and they'll never be heard. They're also afraid of several other things. And I'm going to not talk to my kids. I'm going to tell you what I'm going to tell you. And that is simply this. People are afraid of money. They're afraid of not having enough money. And the people who have money are afraid that they will run out of money. And so when we look at money, one of the things that I told my boys years after years after years was this. You are the money. Money doesn't exist. Money is an accountability of your value. So once you master yourself, once you understand what you're amazing at, and they would always say, like what? I said, like, the easiest thing is an athlete. Take a look at Michael Jordan, or take a look at Isaiah, or some of these, or LeBron James. And understand that they get paid more money than all the other basketball players because they have an exceptional talent. So what you need to do and what we need to do is we need to become experts at creating our value and become so valuable that society cannot deny you your worth. So at that point, you're converting your value to currency. And no one can ever take away your personal potential, your personal expertise. Okay? Now, when you solve millions of problems, you become immensely million times more valuable. So think about it in terms of where you are personally. Now, the other things that people are afraid of are their health. I had an amazing friend who had all of the money he could ever want. He had a private plane, he had two houses. We went to his house for pig roast, and we were on his plane and we jet skied, but he lost his fight for health. So when we talk about what we're afraid of, and there's a pandemic, an epidemic, a redemic, an undemic, an overdemic, we're demic to death. And no amount of washing your hands or wearing masks is going to save you. Because when it comes to your health, you have to take radical ownership. You have to understand that you have to master yourself. And what am I saying to you? It's as much being physically healthy as it is mental health. So we're talking about mastering your mind and your body, being healthy mentally and physically. There's a reason that pharmacies can't keep enough Zoloft on the shelves, because people are taking it just to wake up, just to crack a smile, to make it through the workday, because their mental health is struggling because they not mastered who they are. There's one more thing that people are afraid of: not having happiness. But happiness, just like your money, just like your health, is an inside job. Your mental health, your happiness, has to come from within. If you look outside of yourself to create value or happiness, right, which is an immense value to all of us, understand that it's your responsibility to know that you are who you are and that you're growing one step every day. You don't have to make massive changes. All you need to do is understand that day by day, you can become greater. So it's your right to say to yourself, I am supposed to have health. I am supposed to have happiness. And know that your happiness is not dependent on anyone else. Because if you look at social media and you look at everyone's lives and you understand that in their life, they're showing you a glimpse of one moment of happiness, and everybody's competing so that they can be happy too. But behind the lens, people are sad. Behind the lens, people are unhappy. Behind the lens, people are desperate. They're wanting. And there's no value that you can truly share when that's your disposition. So going back to my boys, I want you to know that each and every one of us wants our boys to grow up to be men. And once they're men, you want them to be safe and secure. You want them to know their value. So if I could, for a second, just go back to my story. So I finished up with the boys talking about the voice and justice and why the people were in the streets. And you may think I'm talking about today, but I'm talking about 20 years ago, the Million Man March. We all want to be heard. So here's what I told them. I said, boys, when I was your age, Nana used to tell me, you can grow up and be anything you want to be. But what I'm telling you is that you can grow up to be an expert at anything you decide to master. And the thing that you must master to create the value that you deserve and the world deserves is inside of you. So go inside and let's figure out what you're amazing at. Let's figure out what no one could ever take from you so that you could create that flow of money, health, and happiness endlessly. Now, we know there's more to the game than that, but that is the foundational principle that each and every one of us needs to share. So I told the boys, I said, listen, before you were born, I chose a profession that put me next to you so that I wouldn't be stuck in an office or stuck on a work shelf, so that I could be there during your hard times, so that I could guide you, so that I could promote you, so that I could teach you your value, so that you would know your worth, so that then you could go to society and you can produce and solve problems, not create problems. Because what we all need is to solve more problems. So the idea we're sharing is simply this. I need you to consider it your duty, your obligation to complete your self-mastery so that we can save each other one star at a time.